Hello, everyone. Back here again, Settler's Lament, for my Christmas special this year. As I was just saying behind the scenes for our panelists here, I imagine this might be a bit shorter than my streams normally are. I just wanted to do something special for Christmas and hopefully encourage a bit of Christmas literacy. I would encourage everyone, you know, to read this or a similar Christmas book for the time of year, even if it's, you know, you don't have much time left to do that. But yeah, so I mean, the stream is pretty self-explanatory. We're going to be doing a book review of A Christmas Carol, the Charles Dickens classic. At some point, we will be going over a video that I forgot to tell my panelists this. 21st, you're the one that knows this. We'll be briefly going over a video that AA did a few years ago defending Scrooge. That's news to four of my panelists. We'll get to that at some point. This was inspired by Badger Imperial here. He did a video on his own channel reviewing A Christmas Carol, and that's why I wanted to do this stream today.
I don't know why I'm a badger, because the two animals that I'm most known for liking, it's foxes and a mongoose. And badger's neither one of them. But anyways, I decided just to make it because as I said in the video, I like to listen to a lot of audiobooks at work. And I said, hey, you know what? I've seen A Christmas Carol, and I think most of us have seen it in so many different formats and adaptations over the years. I just wanted to get to the original source. And I was really surprised by how much more of a religious story, explicitly religious story, it comes across in the original. And the fact that I'm not an expert on Dickens by any means, but like compared to something, the other books of his I've read, like Tale of Two Cities and Great Expectations, you know, Dickens is kind of known for being very, very wordy, very, liberal with his prose, largely because he got paid by the word. But A Christmas Carol, considering that it's such a short book, it is so differently written in that it's so direct that it feels like a religious sermon or a parable. And in a lot of ways it is. And, you know, it's pretty deliberate with its messaging of, if you don't love your fellow man, if you don't love your neighbor as you love yourself, you're going to hell. And yeah, it kind of, and it kind of gave me more of a different perspective on that. A lot of us have kind of, I think, in this sphere or on the dissident right, we kind of look at the celebratory modern way of people observing Christmas and think it's really disgusting, just the level of commercialism. But whilst I still agree with that, I think that there's a danger of sliding into Puritanism, which is just as bad, of saying no fun, no, you know, no celebration whatsoever. But I think A Christmas Carol is really good at kind of emphasizing the idea of joyful celebration and the fact that Scrooge, not only does he not spend any money on other people, he doesn't spend money on himself. And I think that's all. It's such an interesting perspective that I didn't really kind of think about it that way before. And then lastly, I see a lot of parallels between the kind of thinking and the kind of mindset that Dickens is criticizing, which is a puritanical mindset, which is both evident or was kind of what him and his idea of Christmas in the Victorian age was getting rid of, and which has come back now. Because I see there's a line when when Scrooge says, like, you know, they better die now and get rid of the surplus population. And I'm thinking, you know, the White House just came out with saying, if you're unvaccinated, you better prepare for a winter of severe illness and death. And I'm thinking, well, how far we've come. And I'm just hoping that perhaps three ghosts will visit Dr. Fauci this year. So that's my little rant to start us off with.
I hope we can only hope he would certainly need it. I wanted to sort of piggyback off of that and point out something that Fritz actually pointed out, and something that I touched on when I did my video. My video on my channel was sort of a review of this one guy. He wrote it. There was this essay written by a libertarian called The Case for Ebenezer Scrooge, and it set it up as a court case of, like, the lawyer is the libertarian is playing the defense lawyer in court for Ebenezer Scrooge against Charles Dickens, the ghosts, and the Cratchits, who he claims are all conspiring together to steal Scrooge's money in some kind of communist conspiracy. And it is the most bonkers thing I have ever read, but it's pretty typical of libertarians to make arguments like this, surprisingly.
I'm just thinking of a Ben Shapiro voice talking about, well, actually, Scrooge is helping with industrialization, which will lift hundreds of millions of people out of poverty.
That's pretty much the argument he made. That's one of the main arguments, and that's probably one of the least bad arguments he made, too.
But the thing is that he doesn't spend any money on himself, either. That's kind of the point, right? And when when the ghost of Christmas Yet to Come comes in, it's like there's none of the money is left. It's just kind of all dissipated, and all that's left is like is curtain rings. That's it. What wealth?
Yeah. Well, the thing is, Ebenezer Scrooge is pretty much the embodiment of this humorless Puritan, the sort of the Protestant work ethic taken to its logical extreme. You know, if you think of the Protestant work ethic, the sort of idea that someone like Max Weber talked about, it's basically this Calvinist idea that your earthly wealth is a reflection of your industriousness and your virtue, and therefore
isn't that like a televangelist and a prosperity gospel preacher?
The other side of the coin.
It's basically the idea that you wouldn't be wealthy unless you had these virtues, and thus if you accumulate a lot of money, that must mean that you are somehow a good person and God is favorable toward you.
Mm-hmm. So you're saying he's like Cromwell, except if he was a usurer?
Yes.
Yeah, it's kind of like that. He's kind of like atheist Cromwell, which is double cancer. because Cromwell, for all of his faults, was nowhere near as bad as Scrooge. But anyway, so, I mean, one of the parts that stuck out to me was when he had his nephew come over, and his nephew is just inviting Scrooge to a family gathering, and Scrooge is saying, "What reason do you have to be merry? You're poor enough." And then the nephew retorts, "Well, what reason do you have to be dismal? You're rich enough." And keep in mind, the nephew is not poor at all. He has a very comfortable middle-class lifestyle. He has servants, a beautiful wife, who is I think Dickens says at one point that his wife is provocative. because of how pretty she is. He even has a servant or two. So it's not like Scrooge's nephew is kind of...
And you know what? Fred Scrooge, I think that's his name. I know Fred is his nephew's name. He's wealthy and he's able to enjoy his wealth, right? It's Christ told us to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. Well, not only does Scrooge not love his neighbor, he doesn't love himself either. He spends no money on himself. He barely lights his own house.
You guys are actually building up my future Steel Man of Scrooge. So keep going. Keep pulling out that rope.
Mm. Well, I mean, it's kind of interesting because another thing about Scrooge is that he is also, at the same time, he's the ultimate Puritan. He's also kind of a libertarian. He is he's just this guy who says, he follows the letter of the law and fulfills every contract to its T, even if it involves depriving people of their wealth. He basically says, I want to mind my own business and not interfere with the businesses of others. You leave me out of this.
To quote Andrew Ryan, is a man not entitled to the sweat of his brow?
Yeah, I mean, he has that sort of attitude to the point where he claims that paid vacation days are the same as stealing. It's kind of this level of there's a level of illogic to his behavior in how he lives, and it's sort of a reflection of his miserableness. He's stuck doing things that do not make him happy. On some level, he knows that these things do not make him happy. But until he's literally scared out of his ways and given a shock by the four ghosts who visit him, Marley and the ghosts of Christmas past, present, and future, until he's given those visitations, he's sort of mired in his ways and just going along.
The ghosts, by which I like to make the point that they remind me a lot of, like, Ghosts of Christmas Past reminded me of Athena. Present is like, it's like Bacchus, but a Christianized version of Bacchus, and the last one is Hades. There's something like kind of a combination of like Old Testament and like angels, biblical angels, and like Greek gods there. But especially like the Ghost of Christmas Present feels like if like Dionysus, you know, the Greek god of debauchery and wine, was like a Christianized version of it, of like celebration and feasting.
Yeah, very true. He's an extremely cheery and celebratory character.
But he also yells at Scrooge the most.
I mean, that's another thing. The Ghost of Christmas Present is not afraid to be very sardonic towards Scrooge. And I noticed that his sort of political, the author's sort of political pet issues sort of come out of the mouth of the Ghost of Christmas Present, like when he lectures Scrooge on his surplus population a remark, and also when he goes there's a part where he
the part about the poorhouses and the prisons that he brings back up. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and but there's also this other part where he talks about blue laws. At the time that Dickens was writing this, there was this group that was trying to get bakeries closed down on Sundays because it's the Lord's Day, even though closing down those stores would mean these normal people probably wouldn't be able to have eat out as a family or something like that. And Scrooge brings this up, and the Ghost of Christmas Present sort of waves aside, and he says, there are many bigoted people out there who claim to be working in my interests, but their ways are strange to us in my kin. And something like that, and sort of denigrating those Christian fundamentalists at the time who were trying to just close everything down on Sundays because it's the Lord's Day.
Okay, Dave, what do you have to say?
Well, I actually have not read this particular Dickens.
What?
But yeah, does the book version have the most haunting element of Christmas present when he unfurls his robe and displays the two ghosts that are underneath it?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
It is quite similar to the to the original. Or I don't know if it's the original, but I think the movie from the 1930s, that I think that's the one I normally watch.
The one I've seen the most was the one with Mr. Magoo or the one with Scrooge McDuck, which is ironic because Scrooge McDuck is the opposite of a miser. You see his giant swimming pool full of money.
But yes, it is quite similar to most of the classic movies.
I've seen the play like a billion times. You know, I don't know who dramatized it, but there's a very popular dramatization that they always use.
Yeah, I've read that before, and it's been a long time since I've read it, but from reading the actual Dickens text, there's not really much noticeable difference other than the specific language used. So
I think he brings up Jesus more in the original.
I heard you say that in your review, Fritz, but I only remember Jesus being mentioned once in the entire thing.
He mentions it a few times of like, this is the reason, you know, like him kind of winking at the reader going like, Christ is the reason why we're celebrating in the first place anyway.
Well, I mean, yeah, it's brought up it's brought up that the main reason for the season is the religious aspect. And Scrooge's fireplace actually has Scrooge's fireplace has depictions of different scenes from the Old Testament.
Yeah,
And Marley comes out for, I think it describes Marley in that scene. It describes in the scene that they describe the fireplace, it describes Marley as playing the role of a prophet. And that's very interesting to me.
Well, it's obviously mimicking the prophets that prophesized Christ.
Right. Because what Marley does is he prophesizes the coming of the three ghosts of Christmas that will haunt Scrooge, and he's very I personally think that Marley is perhaps the scariest of the ghosts because he's there are some pretty terrible parts, like one where he unties the thing around the sort of bonnet around his neck and unhinges his jaw, and he makes and he just screams at the top of his lungs at random intervals.
In the theatrical adaptation, I've been to the play version of it. That's when like the actor is like, I want to scare the daylights out of the audience as much as I can because I'm a theater nerd and I think it's funny.
Well, the thing is that he does that in the play. In the book, whenever Scrooge is trying to add a bit of levity, like when he makes that you're nothing more than my imagination, there's more
you're
of
sour gruel.
There's more of gravy than of the grave in you. And Marley
I like his like skeptic attitude. It's like, why don't you prove that you're really a ghost? Do you have a peer-reviewed study?
And then the ghost has an answer for that, which is, I'm going to scare you out of your wits until you believe me. Mm-hmm. Which is, what it would take for a skeptic to admit the existence of God.
The fear of God is the beginning of wisdom.
God is the beginning of wisdom, exactly.
The interesting thing about Scrooge's skepticism is, you know, you read his internal monologue in the book, and his internal monologue makes it clear that his skepticism is just put on because he kind of knows that the ghosts are real, and he's sort of putting on this face of, I guess, faux bravery to try and distract his own mind from what he actually knows to be true, which possibly characterizes atheist skepticism quite a bit. So I thought that was interesting from that perspective.
Isn't like the Peter Hitchens argument? I know he's not the one who made it up or came up with it, but his thing of like, it's more that why don't they want there to be a God? What are they afraid of?
Well, his book, I'm the biggest Peter Hitchens fan here, I'll say that. And his book, I didn't read the book, but he did several lectures on this. But
you're the biggest Peter Hitchens fan. You don't read his book.
I listen to everything he says. I might as well have read some of his books. But yeah,
the absolute state of Zoomers.
The Rage Against God.
That's my favorite book. That's one of his best. I may not have read Christmas Carol, but I've read 3 or 4 Christopher Hitchens books.
Peter Hitchens. But Peter Hitchens, pardon me.
I've read Christopher Hitchens too.
As we know, reading the book is an admission of weakness of not truly knowing the subject.
I've already internalized the message because I understood the rage. These people have rage because they do certain things.
Now I'm just imagining Richard Dawkins encountering this. Well, how can anyone believe this silly story about the ghost? We know ghosts aren't real. And there's like a ghost literally standing in front of him. You're just a figment.
Yeah, that's this kind of gets on a side issue we could talk about. But 21st, what was your actual point about Peter Hitchens?
Well, he just talks about, it's not just the point that he makes about why don't they want God to be true. Why don't they want to? Is it that they don't want to be accountable for their actions and everything? No, he goes deeper and describes it as this kind of like fundamental rage that they have about, existing or things not really going their way. Perhaps, this is cliche, but kind of in line with their anger against their father and other authority figures and everything. It really is this, the underlying assumption is always in terms of what they actually say, not what they say they believe, but what they actually say. It always communicates that, that they know he's there, they know he's daddy, and they're just really mad at him, and they have a bone to pick because their lives didn't go the way they wanted it to. So they have this kind of rage.
This also sort of gets transformed into modern psychological practices. One of the things I notice about atheists or agnostics is that whenever they have some sort of mental health problem, the number of hoops they have to jump through to sort of understand what their problem is and how to solve it always strike me as absurd. And usually there's some series of biological arguments justifying some anxiety or this or that feeling, as opposed to simply, confronting the spiritual aspect directly.
Mm-hmm. It's kind of, that's it. That is something that now that I think about it, when we look at this, the figure of Scrooge, I said earlier that he's sort of the puritanical figure, sort of made into a caricature by Dickens, but doesn't he reflect, or rather, the later figures in the modern day, like the libertarian, the new atheist, and so on, sort of reflect this earlier Puritan prototype. So, Puritan, Moldbugian Puritan thesis confirmed.
I think this whole book is pretty obviously a criticism of 19th century English liberalism. So, in a sense, for libertarians like screeching about how this is a communist book, it obviously isn't a communist book, but it is a book that is explicitly criticizing economic liberalism.
I wouldn't even say, I mean, it's not even criticizing like people making money. It's criticizing the fact that, you know, being a miserable, horrible person, vile, pathetic person that is ignoring one of Christ's commandments.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I guess one thing, at least, I suppose, in favor, when we get to the AA video later on, one of the things that he criticizes the most is how Scrooge cancels everyone's debts in whatever movie adaptation he's referring to. But that's not something that does happen in the book. So
what about the guy with the back payments that are covered or something?
I think that's what's shown in when he's like searching for, hey, ghosts of Christmas yet to come, you know, when I die, please let there be somebody that was like fond of my existence. And like the closest thing they can get is there's like this poor couple that's happy that he's dead because now they don't have to pay back the loans they owe him.
Speaking of loans, one interesting point here being that Scrooge is a lender is that, you know, even for very wealthy people today who could be very generous with their money, aren't in many cases. I think because if you look at rich people's assets, basically, they'll often be like way over leveraged and way into debt. So in one sense, they're actually not very wealthy at all because their debt is enormous. And this idea where everyone just takes on enormous debt sort of puts this pressure on people to where you feel much more unable to be generous with your money, even if you could potentially give away a lot of money because there's this enormous amount of money you owe someone else, even if on paper you know, are very wealthy.
Yeah, I mean, I try to emphasize time and again that it's not explicit in the while it's not explicit in the novel, I read Scrooge as a usurer in a lot of ways. I mean, I might not know too much about Victorian economics, but usury in some form was probably legal back then, and Scrooge was going to ruin this one couple. But because he's following the letter of his contract, his contract with them, and that goes against Christian morality. I don't care what the libertarians claim is economically sound or not. It goes against Christian morals to lend money at interest.
I mean, that's the kind of logical conclusion we can see right now is the student loan crisis and the fact that you have plenty of conservatives saying, well, no, you borrowed money, you pay it back. But it's like, here's the thing. It's like when you look at the interest rates and the fact that these people will never pay back this debt, as you know, they will be debt slaves until they die because it is impossible for them to pay it back. That is usury. Like, I don't know how you can like get around that. Even more modern Catholic understanding of usury of like, well, you can charge interest, but just not exploitatively. This is exploitative. And it's like, the reason why I'm in favor of canceling it, it's just because of the fact that I don't think that 17 and 18 year olds should be held financially responsible for the rest of their lives for a decision that they were largely pressured into by other people.
Yeah, but let's be clear. Let's be clear who's taking the haircut here, right? Mm-hmm. People taking the haircut. This doesn't go to the taxpayers. It goes to the universities. They file Chapter 11. Then maybe it goes to the taxpayers.
Hmm. Yeah, I mean,
that's the way to deal with it. There's no if the universities can. I mean, you know, I really sympathize with student loan and I agree with Fritz, but if the universities can rope the taxpayers in to fully compensate an $80,000, you know, education that basically indoctrinates an activist class and provides no skills, then
No, yeah, you know,
we're basically participating in class warfare against the lower class.
No, that's why I thought. I mean, I believe that, yeah, a way to alleviate it should be, it shouldn't just be, oh, you know, the universities get off scot-free. It should be kind of, there should be some form of punishment onto them for doing this. But back to
conscript them.
So, I don't know, but I want to talk about Scrooge more. But like,
yeah,
because something I might argue, or my controversial take, is that something that's refreshing and kind of, I think it's a story that's needed now, even though I don't think it's relevant at all today because it comes from such a different time. And it's something that strikes me, and I said this in the video, right, is that the unabashed sincerity and guilelessness of it, you couldn't make this story today. People would think this is like a Hallmark movie and it's cringe and overly saccharine. And it's kind of why I have a problem with some of the adaptations, because it's like everything in modern media is dripping with cynicism, that even something that's supposed to be sincere can't fully get away from it.
Well, you couldn't make the Muppet Christmas Carol today, let alone the original sincere Dickens one.
Mm-hmm.
You can't make a Christmas Carol where they're breaking the fourth wall jokes every 10 minutes.
And it's like the stupid, it's the opposite of like that, you know, the Jim Carrey Grinch movie is possibly the most, I think that's that movie I hate more than anything else, because I remember when I was like 5 or 6 when it came out, like we were visiting like my aunt and uncle, and like a bunch of people were going to go see it. And like, I was scared of the commercials because I was like 5 and I thought the Grinch was scary, so I didn't want to go. Now I'm terrified of that movie for different reasons, namely the fact that anybody likes it, because it is sickening, disgusting, vile, and like just, I know it wasn't directed by Tim Burton, but it's that stupid modern Tim Burton idea of, we're going to take a fairy tale but make it like edgy Hot Topic crap.
Is Danny Elfman the conductor?
I don't know. It's directed by Ron Howard, but
maybe.
Sorry, I hate it. That's why there's a Christmas decoration that I like driving by on my way back and forth from work, where somebody took the head of the Grinch from that movie, the Jim Carrey one, and it looks like they cut his head off and stuck it onto like their mailbox, like they put his head on a stick. So I like the idea of them having murdered the Grinch, because I hate that, and I hate Jim Carrey's portrayal. Sorry, I'm a little triggered by that.
Well, we mentioned the nephew character. The nephew is a really interesting character. He's probably my favorite one in the whole story, just because of how utterly unfazed he is by Scrooge's excessive rudeness. He just maintains an absolute good cheer and very genuinely wishes him Merry Christmas, regardless of Scrooge's insistence on not celebrating and being.
He definitely rude. Is the Chad of the story. He even married to a Becky.
Yes.
You know? Married to a
Stacy. Stacy, yeah.
Sorry, Stacy.
Yeah,
I'm surprised. Sorry.
Just a clap back from the audience. Marcher for $2.50. The Grinch is a classic. WTF.
The original animated one, not the Jim Carrey one.
Jim Carrey is like this insane, like, social sky raised by a single mom, and he like overacts everything. That's his shtick. So it's like always going to be very off-putting and disturbing.
Is this as bad as the Cat in the Hat with Michael Myers?
Nothing is as bad as the Cat in the Hat with Michael Myers.
But I don't know. It's been so long. I don't really want to get too much into this stuff today. Though, I mean, you know, we can if you guys want to. But you sort of said this at the beginning, Fritz. But I think a lot of contemporary Christmas culture is deeply subversive and just terrible and atheistic.
Yeah, I agree. Like, even Santa Claus, who is based on St. Nicholas, right? Like, that connection is completely lost. I really, you know, you have the Coca-Cola Santa Claus as well. I really, really dislike the modern Santa Claus character because it just completely distracts from the actual Christian elements of Christmas is supposed to be.
Perhaps like the Victorian era, him being essentially a spirit of generosity, I'm okay with, but...
Well, yeah, I mean, but Santa is just now the centerpiece of of Christmas, as if like Christmas is about Santa. Just like it's sure. He's literally like the Easter Bunny of Christmas, right? It's totally replaced Christ.
Yeah, he's no, like, it. Man. I feel like a lot of this stuff is cliche. Criticisms about Christmas, and one in particular is the Santa Claus movie, like clauses in a contract.
Oh, Tim Allen.
Yeah.
Where he murders Santa Claus.
Yeah, I grew up watching those. I loved them when I was a kid, but it seems very obvious to me as an adult now that it's a bad parody for religion. That sort of the message of the movie is that you should believe in Santa despite there not being any evidence for Santa. And as a child, if you still believe in Santa, that might be sound fine. But once you, grow up a few years.
I'm sorry. Are you being a Santa denier right here?
Yes, I am. Seriously, the message seems to me like something like a atheist's parody of what religious people believe.
I think one of the worst Christmas movies, though, and I saw it as a kid, but is if you've ever seen the movie Jingle All the Way with Arnold Schwarzenegger.
That's definitely down there.
It's like, because I saw Red Letter Media has like a commentary track for it, and they made a good point where if that movie had been made by like Paul Verhoeven at the time, and it was just a complete satire on like the commercial Christmas, where the whole, because the actual plot of the movie is literally just he's trying to buy a toy to earn his son's love for Christmas instead of being a good dad. And it's like if you had like just somebody pointing out how horrible that is, like then it would have been interesting. But the movie kind of plays it, on that half satire, but also wants you to be sincere, and it just comes across as like disgusting.
I don't remember that movie at all.
That's probably for the best.
Oh, I do. That movie, that was a stinker even at the time. No one thought that movie was good.
Even Phil Hartman couldn't save it.
I don't know why the onslaught of criticisms against my beloved Scrooge. You didn't bring up the Malthusian one where he's like, it'll decrease the surplus population if they go ahead and die, the invalids and everything.
Look, for Christmas, in order to save the environment, no turkeys, no gooses, no ham for Christmas. You got to eat bugs and cockroach milk and you got to be social distance to flatten the curve, right? Like, I mean, that's the other thing is like, we're a society run by Scrooges. Like I love this. I looked up the personal life of Dr. Fauci. He says he's not Catholic. He was raised Catholic, but he describes himself as a humanist. I'm like, really? Everything you do is completely misanthropic. You seem to have nothing but an absolute disdain for humanity.
And there's the perfect quote for this, and it applies to all the Scrooges now and Scrooge then. So after Scrooge was saying, the better get rid of the surplus population if those invalids die already. So when he's in with the, I think it's the first ghost, not Bob Marley, but the first ghost of Christmas Past, the ghost tells him, addressing to him, "Man," said the ghost, "if man you be in heart, not adamant, no, forbear that wicked cant until you have discovered what the surplus is and where it
that
is."
That was the, well, that was the ghost of Christmas Present, actually.
Oh, there we go. "Will you decide what men shall live?" What, and this is in the context of Tiny Tim. So there's this poor little crippled kid and everything. "Will you decide what men shall live, what men shall die? It may be that in the sight of heaven, you are more worthless and less fit to live than millions like this poor man's child. Oh God, to hear the insect on the leaf pronouncing on the too much life among his hungry brothers in the dust."
Did somebody
and that say, totally applies to the Scrooges we have now. It's literally just,
yeah. The people are, it is a complete inhumane. The people running our societies don't actually view humanity as like human beings.
They've become so drunk with power that they literally decided now we're going to choose who lives and dies. That's literally where they're at.
Well, I mean, we have to understand that, there are a lot of different interpretations of what Scrooge meant by that. He could have been just dismissing them by saying, look, just calling their bluff is saying, well, if those people actually do want to die rather than go to the workhouses, then go ahead, do it, as a sort of a bluff, because he thinks in his mind that, oh, the workhouses, they're not that bad. And
look, it's a good thing that Chinese children are working in sweatshops, because they're ultimately, you know, helping build the strong capitalist society.
And they will have been working in rural places where they will have had higher mortality rates.
Yeah, yeah. Without the the whole libertarian argument for the sweatshops. But I think it goes back to something that does happen when he's visiting his past, when he's talking to the woman he used to love, Belle, when she's breaking up with him on Christmas. She tells him that Scrooge has replaced her with an idol, and that idol is, money, greed, mammon, basically. And she says that the reason Scrooge is chasing after money is because he's just so afraid, he's so paranoid of falling into poverty. That is the obsession that drives him to gain more money. He wants to avoid poverty at all costs.
He's got like five side hustles.
Yeah, and so that love of money consumes him to the point where he only starts to value things according to, well, how much money will this give me, including his fellow man. The only person before he visits the past in the ghosts, the only person he shows any amount of admiration for, respect for, is his old friend Marley, because he was a good business partner. Otherwise, he doesn't really show any kind of respect towards anybody. And it's really when he goes back into the past and he's reminded, you know, has this nostalgic moment. There's this beautiful nostalgic moment where he sees himself reading basically some of the classics, like 1001 Arabian Nights, things like, Robinson Crusoe, Treasure Island, and things like that. He sees his younger self reading those books as a kid.
Probably not Treasure Island, which is published after.
Shut up, Dave. Sorry. Thank you for correcting me, but it was probably Robinson.
Sorry, Crusoe. I was being a dick.
It's fine. It's fine. Yeah, it's fine. You corrected me. I misremembered. It was Robinson Crusoe, probably. But he just for a moment the narration describes those characters as if they were real, and that's sort of the nostalgia that Scrooge gets. And so that's and it's kind of funny, because that's nostalgia for these old stories is what starts breaking him out of his it's the first emotion he has, first emotion of genuine happiness that he has in the entire novel,
and he's able to kind of remember, ironically, like he's able to kind of pretty easily empathize with and love, like when him and Fezziwig and his and Dick, his old friend, just having a nice celebration of Christmas, and just like, hey, we don't have to work anymore, we're done with working for today, you know. Just the complete polar opposite of what he's dealing with now.
Yeah, and the funny thing is, when he sees that, he starts to realize, oh, I could have done that with Bob Cratchit. Maybe I should start. Maybe I should do something for him, like Mr. Fezziwig did for me.
Mm-hmm.
One other thing I'd like to mention is about the three ghosts in particular. You know, you mentioned earlier that they're sort of Christianized Greek gods, or ain't the novel seems to identify them with angels. Mm-hmm. I think each one represents each one is showing Scrooge visions of different aspects of, you know, his sin, and also the opposite of sin, the kinds of life, the happiness that he could have. So the Ghost of Christmas Past shows him both the happiness that he used to have and also his past sins, which are so shameful he begs the spirit not to show him anymore. And the Ghost of Christmas Present does confront him with what his sins have caused in the present, but also shows him, you know, the lives of other people and what happiness Scrooge might have had he chosen to live a life more like them. And then
the fact that Bob Cratchit and his family are still happy and joyful, even though they're really poor.
Yeah, and the Ghost of Christmas Yet to Come sort of represents sort of the wages of sin, which is death. You know, death. Basically, Scrooge is forced to come face to face with his own mortality in a very dramatic way.
I'm reminded of when Christ says, you know, don't store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth will and rust will eat at them and thieves will take them. And like, again, I kind of pointed this out earlier, is it shows like, I think they just mentioned that, well, all of the wealth he made at his lending firm just kind of got distributed to other like various business partners, but like any of his actual wealth is just gone. It's just like all the most expensive thing he had were his curtain rings that just get pawned off to like some thieves and like low life degenerates.
Yeah, low life. I mean, both the narrator and Scrooge are in agreement when they depict them as just being these bottom feeders. I mean, it describes Scrooge as looking upon them as if they are carving up his corpse.
Undeserving poor. Where were they the entire? They save them for the end, because then Scrooge might have looked vindicated when it's like some heroin addict is asking him for money.
21st, there is a difference between the undeserving poor and the deserving poor.
Yes.
And that's really, I mean, Dickens knows that there are people out there who are undeserving.
And I think that's why it's not a commie book and everything, because he includes those people at the end, like being vultures on his body, really showed I think he understood. He wasn't such a was he a Chartist and everything? This is the same time period, right? It's like they were talking about the poor law, which came into effect around that time.
To be honest though, I don't think Dickens' primary aim was for this to be political. I think the point was he's like making a sincere point about, you know, love your neighbor and Christmas.
But the thing is, I can agree with you that his aim was primarily moral rather than strictly economic in a kind of communistic Marxist sense. But at the same time, Dickens is trying to show that the personal vices of this one man, Scrooge, is in a way something that has a negative impact.
Okay, 21st, we can hear that dog barking in the background.
Oh, that's my dog. I'm sorry.
That's you.
Okay. Wow. I see how it is.
I apologize. I don't know what's wrong with my dog. I'm going to go over and try and calm him down.
I don't think there's any Marxist or communistic implications in here. I think he was just a base distributist. I think he was.
Yeah, no, I mean, yes, I think this can only be considered in any even remote sense communist if you're a hysterical libertarian who can't handle any criticism of wealth or markets.
It also came out several years before the Communist Manifesto anyway.
Yeah, I mean, I guess to be fair to some libertarians, I mean, the use of this in that light is probably pretty tongue-in-cheek, so I wouldn't, you know, go all in. It might be kind of cringe, but, you know, we could probably cut them a little bit of slack there, because it's, you know, it's clever to, you know, pick the villain side and make them out to be the good guys, you know, kind of like you do with the Empire and Star Wars.
Yeah, yeah, that's what
I don't really know what you're talking about. The Empire, just the good guys.
Yeah, what?
You mean the Confederacy, right?
Yeah, well, yes.
I mean, the thing is, there used to be this thing where you didn't have to use critical theory to look into books. Like, you didn't have to say, well, let's look at this through a libertarian lens. Let's look at this through a post-colonial lens. Like, geez, why don't you just look at it and read it for what it is? Because it seemed pretty obvious to me that Dickens was being as explicit and bashing you over the head with it as much as he could. Like, I don't think he could be clearer as to what his intention was.
Well, yeah, I agree. I think it's a cringe type of humor to take that sort of it's very postmodernist. I don't know, it doesn't feel right to take something like this and like apply a political lens to it. That doesn't belong there.
You guys say that it's obvious, but when I looked at this libertarian and he did this review, the libertarian, it was so bad, it's almost like he didn't read the book. He tried to claim that the nephew Fred was a champagne socialist. He claimed that Bob Cratchit was you know,
he's did Charlie Kirk make this video?
He claimed that Bob Cratchit was only poor because he was lazy, and that Bob Cratchit should basically try to learn new skills or find a new employer if he's not satisfied with Scrooge's wages. And the fact that he continues to work for Scrooge shows that he actually, for all his complaining, he actually prefers that.
That's more. An interesting point, because that's a very toxic mentality, because what that guy, whoever made this video, is doing is basically encouraging some level of nomadism, which, you know, we would view as bad, of course. Like, there's no reason that Bob Cratchit should have to go to, not that learning new skills and bettering yourself is bad, or that, you know, you can't ever change employers, but the idea that you should just like move around to new places and change your who you are in order to
become
fit in economically.
Cosmopolitan.
Yeah, exactly.
It's literally telling Bob Cratchit, learn to code, man, or the 19th century version.
make an analog computer, bro.
But it gets even worse. Because he uses the Austrian view of revealed preference. The idea is, if you are the Austrian libertarian view of happiness, is that happiness consists merely in the satisfaction of desire. So if you are choosing to do with your actions some task, that means you are happy doing that. And it argues from that to conclude that Scrooge actually didn't need to change because he was perfectly happy the way he was.
That would be incorrect if that's how the Austrian economic theory is described in the video.
They're almost correct there. It's kind of Aquinas pilled, where it's like, you know, even like a, let's say a, like a dejected person, like behaving in line with their disposition of sorrow, like being not moving much, not saying much, whatever, there's a certain pleasure in that. That's what Aquinas says about it. But that doesn't necessarily mean that they fully understand like the end, the good that they're pursuing.
Well, I mean, the thing is, I think what the libertarian view gets wrong is that it confuses satisfaction or pleasure with happiness in a kind of in a kind of human fulfillment, human flourishing sense.
So, I mean, some libertarians do that, but I don't think Austrian economic theory talks about pleasure specifically or happiness per se.
Well, I mean,
it's more about the subjective fulfillment of. It's subjective theory of value that every whatever action you're taking is preferred to some other action that you could have taken.
I mean Aquinas believes that too. I mean, but the difference is Aquinas also has, in addition to this theory of human action, he also has a objective ordering of goods. And he recognizes that even if all of your subjective desires are fulfilled and satisfied, you might fail to achieve happiness if you do not achieve some objective good. Whereas the libertarian says that, no, there is no objective good, or if there is an objective order of goods, it's irrelevant to my economic theory, so we're just going to ignore that for now. And we're going to just pretend like if everybody's subjective desires are fulfilled, then that's pretty much the same as happiness for all intents and purposes.
Well, some libertarians might do that, but there are definitely libertarians who are Christians that would take the exact same view as Aquinas does.
You're really steel manning Radlib here.
I mean,
I love it.
Well, I can't you know, I can't.
I mean, this particular, to be fair, this particular libertarian that I reviewed was especially bad. Like,
this type of libertarian definitely exists, and they're, you hate to see it because they're introducing these concepts. They're the reason libertarianism is awful, right? Basically, is because they dilute Austrian economic theory to just, the pursuit of pleasure or happiness,
utilitarianism, almost.
Yes, and to they create this. They also dilute it to just like the idea of seeking wealth and money, which isn't really what Austrian economic theory is about. But libertarianism, especially as a political weapon, is often just about like, you know, maximizing profit in terms of dollars. So this is a cancer in libertarianism.
I mean, it gets worse because he actually claims that, Mr. Fezziwig was wasting money when he threw these parties for his employees and offloading the costs onto the customers. And it's just like, what?
No, I'm sorry
Did we read the same text?
Now I'm starting to think, because I'd also been trying to reading through The Count of Monte Cristo, and like before he starts going on this full transformation into The Count of Monte Cristo, he like does all this nice stuff for the people that were nice to him, and that kind of reminds me of like Scrooge post-conversion, as it were. And I'm just thinking, man, libertarians would have a field day trying to explain the ideas behind that, because he's like, so what you're saying, this guy becomes the richest person on Earth just to troll people.
Gentlemen, I guess so.
Okay.
But this libertarian dialectic, who cares about the libertarians, right? Who cares about putting it? Who cares about putting it in the modern liberal frame? Some other postmodern. All we need to do is the one true frame dialectic to look at this through is the based in cell autist dialectic. And let's be clear here. Scrooge is indeed a based incel autist. He's reclusive. He's reclusive. He doesn't like talking to people. He refuses to simp. All of these things are great qualities.
Is what you're saying, 21st, is the story then is actually about the normies destroying the power levels of Scrooge and
his base sigma
normie
male grind set.
It's kind of funny because even though he's redeemed at the end, but there's nowhere in there does it say that Scrooge ceased being a lifelong bachelor at any point.
Well, essentially, he just became the adoptive father of like Bob Cratchit and Tiny Tim.
I guess so. But yeah, he's sort of a father figure for the community at the end.
He's a signal. You have to understand his grind set.
Okay,
guys, I'm not feeling very well. Sorry, Settler's Lament. But
no worries.
Okay.
Have a Merry Christmas, Dave.
Have a Merry Christmas. Okay.
Have a Merry Christmas. Yes.
I want to do some super chats. Cringewalker for $5. Ironic. He hated the Grinch so much he became a Grinch who hates the Grinch who hated Christmas. So true. Very accurate.
I'm a Grinch. My arm hair is turning green as we speak.
It's been so long since I've watched The Grinch that I can't really remember.
The animated one from like the 70s is fine. The book is fine, but Jim Carrey sucks, and the newer movie is evil. Is pure evil.
As I said earlier, I think a lot of mainstream Christmas stuff is bad.
I mean,
I'd like to watch it again, you know, being based in Red Pilled now, and look out for.
I can't. But speaking of those, it's why I kind of like. I've started to appreciate like some of the Christmas movies from like the 40s. Like I was visiting my parents the other day, and they were watching The Man Who Came to Dinner, which is like a 1942 comedy starring Monty Woolley, who's just like this crazy old man who is like this famous and wealthy author who gets into like a car accident or something outside this rich couple's house and just kind of moves in and threatens to sue them if they don't like let him stay in a wheelchair and like run the downstairs of their house. And the entire movie is just him like sitting in a wheelchair making fun of people, and it's legitimately funny. But it makes me think of there's something so quaint and nice about those older movies where you can tell this could have just been a play, and like there's still more of a sincerity to it, you know. Like The Bishop's Wife is also really good, which if you're Anglican, that's like, okay, that's just the title of the movie. If you're Catholic, you're like, wait, what? But yeah, that and like Miracle on 34th Street and This Wonderful Life, those are all wonderful movies. I recommend them.
Yeah. Moving on, another one. Constantine for $5. The War on Christmas is real, folks. They laughed at us for years, but take a look around. Yeah, I mean, definitely true. You know, I'm certainly would not counter signal this. There's definitely, you know, a war on the traditional elements of Christmas. But as I've been saying, a lot of what we now accept as traditional elements of Christmas, movies and stuff from the past several decades, they're not really things to defend to begin with. So in a certain sense, it's just sort of progressivism destroying already progressive and secular things. I think this basically encapsulates the entirety of the modern concept of Santa Claus. I know there's a lot of Santa stands out there who are going to get angry at me for saying that, but I think the entire concept of Santa Claus that we have is probably just terrible and should be done away with.
I deny Santa Claus and affirm Saint Nicholas.
Me too. Yeah, no, and I know I always get people saying, "Oh, no, Santa Claus exists." You know, he's Saint Nicholas, but I mean that's just the name concept fallacy. That doesn't mean anything. The modern concept of Santa Claus has nothing to do with Saint.
I guarantee 90% of people don't even know that Santa is Saint Nicholas.
Right.
Santa Claus, the relation between Santa Claus and Saint Nicholas, I actually read quite a bit about this. I actually did a school project for this in college for one of my history classes. I took a course on the history of childhood in America, and Santa Claus was a huge part of this. And it's basically the relationship between the simulacra and the original, the real McCoy. So you had the you had a saint who was very popular in European countries because his he's associated with all these miracles and all these stories of his generosity towards children. And so people celebrated his feast day, which is on December 6th, by giving children presents. And
specifically in their shoes, right?
In their shoes and their stockings. And in Protestant countries, this idea of gift giving still continued even after the Reformation, because it was just so popular. And of course, they would sometimes replace it. Like in Germany, they replaced Saint Nicholas with Christ Child, or Christkind, which is the actually is the origin of Santa Claus's nickname, Kris Kringle. Christ Child in German is something like Kris Kringle or something like that. Anyway, so what happened was in the Dutch countries, in the Netherlands, they called Saint Nicholas Sinterklaas, and they depicted him as a Catholic bishop riding a white horse. And they took this sort of view of Santa Claus or Saint Nicholas over to America, and then the Americans sort of took this idea and poked fun of it in these cartoons, making fun of the Dutch. Instead of depicting him as wearing bishop's garments, they depicted him as looking like a Dutchman, which is the signature red fur coat that he's now depicted as wearing. And then a bunch of people like Washington Irving and other sort of Puritan adjacent people,
by the way. Oh, wait, no. Well, no, I was thinking of Irving Berlin. Never mind.
Washington Irving is a different guy. He's the guy who wrote Sleepy Hollow. He and others like him wanted to use Santa Claus as a way to make Christmas more child-friendly, child-oriented, because back then, they didn't even like saying Merry Christmas, because Merry implied drunkenness. And
I thought you were going to say, it says Merry. Are they Catholic by saying Merry?
No. Christmas was associated with drunkenness, with street fights, people invading other people's houses.
So Catholicism.
So this was yet another reason that Scrooge was so based. He was against the excessive merriment and decadence, especially in the period before Christmas.
Well, it's kind of
the Advent, which is the Advent season, which is meant to be penitential and sorrowful.
I mean,
but no, he waits to be.
I don't think they celebrated Advent.
But he waits to be bubbly and festive till after Christmas, which is the feast and the celebration. So he's against the drunkenness.
He wasn't planning on being bubbly and happy on Christmas.
If I could,
this is about the base dialectic settler.
Well,
it's
kind of funny because Charles Dickens was in A Christmas Carol was also part of this sort of broad movement within Protestantism to try and redeem Christmas from being a holiday about drunkenness and degeneracy and make it more family oriented and child friendly.
On this topic, I've mentioned many times on this channel that I'm a fan of Douglas Wilson, Presbyterian. He's a Presbyterian pastor. I remember he's from a Calvinist background. So I do believe he celebrates Christmas. But he still sort of gives apologetics for the traditional Calvinist Puritan banning of Christmas. And what he said about it is like Mardi Gras comes from the day before the start of Lent. That for anyone who's unaware of where like the modern practice of Mardi Gras comes from, and he
Carnival.
Said basically what?
It's Carnival.
Yeah. And he said it's basically like banning Mardi Gras today. It's not like because you hate Lent. It would be because of the practices associated with it, and that he says that's essentially what banning Christmas for the Puritans was like.
Well, yeah, and I personally don't blame them Though I think the later Protestants had a better solution. In any case, what happened after Santa Claus became this icon of Christmas is that more authors like Thomas Nast and L. Frank Baum, added more to this lore of Santa Claus. And it was kind of fascinating. First, they added that he rode reindeer, that he lived at the North Pole. That was the whole North Pole thing came about sometime in the 1850s or 60s. And he was served by elves, that he's immortal. Frank Baum, the author of The Wizard of Oz, was actually one of the main people who contributed a lot to this.
He has his book called like the Further Adventures of like Santa Claus or something.
Yeah, he created this entire backstory where Santa Claus was an immortal who is a part of this council of pagan deities and fairies. I read the book. It was pretty much as weird as anything else from the Wizard of Oz series.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of which, did you know there was a 19? This is getting off topic for a second, but there's a 1925 movie of the Wizard of Oz, 14 years before the one everyone thinks about. But what I was also going to say is, I'm just imagining, because you know how Santa shows up in the Chronicles of Narnia. It's just somebody, it Father reminds me Christmas. Of Father Christmas does, but yeah, how it reminds me of like somebody said, like, if it's a picture of like if C.S. Lewis wrote Lord of the Rings, and it shows when Frodo and the gang are gonna leave on the ships to like the from the Grey Havens, and Santa just shows up randomly.
that part of the Narnia books was kind of funny, but in any case, I think I sort of said my piece. The point is that, you know, Santa Claus was sort of a propaganda thing from day one. I mean, they took it from the moment they took Saint Nicholas or Santa Claus and rechristened them as Santa Claus. That was a propaganda thing. I mean, Santa Claus. One of the main things that made Santa Claus popular was the depicting him. Was the depictions of him made by Thomas Nast, who was one of who was a very prominent Republican political cartoonist who created this pro-unionist propaganda featuring Santa Claus during the Civil War.
You know, there's actually a painting of like Santa Claus giving Robert E. Lee a sword.
That's it, huh? Okay, well,
I
probably not written made by Thomas Nast.
No, but. It makes me think about this is that I forgot what I was going to say. Never mind. Go ahead.
So I think now would be a good time to do that.
There is actually one last thing I'd like to bring up, and it's something I brought up in the video. If you don't mind, is like,
yeah, go ahead.
One of the more emotional, I guess for me, the more emotional moments is when the Ghost of Christmas Present is taking Scrooge across the world, showing him that people in a coal mine, people in a lighthouse, people on a ship in the middle of the ocean are celebrating Christmas. And it seems like, and it's how I kind of connected it. For some reason, it reminded me of the Christmas truce in World War I, in which there is this kind of spirit of it, that the birth of Christ has a way of bringing forth, you know, a spirit of brotherhood and generosity. And it showed how, like, something is like the Christmas truce could not happen today, because unlike then, where, you know, Germany, France, and the UK were all still decidedly Christian countries, and they said, okay, for one day, we're going to stop this industrial scale war for one day. that would not happen today. If tomorrow Russia invaded Ukraine, you think there's any possibility that the woke McMilitary and like the EU would even have the idea of like, oh, well, no, we have to conduct this war as Christians. No. And so it just kind of reminds me of like part of the world that we've lost, in which there is this kind of understanding, this mutual understanding across Christendom of Christmas.
Did we steam over something Charlemagne was saying? I forget.
No, don't think so.
Well,
no. Oh, there was one thing I was going to say. I'll just say it real quick. One of the interesting things about the story is the ghosts are, if you want to apply the story, I guess, the ghosts are kind of unnecessary in a sense, because all that's actually happening in the story really is that Scrooge is just self-reflecting on his own sins, which is something you can do without the ghosts at all. And, you know, that's kind of the point of the story, I think, is that, you know, you can look at your own actions, particularly during Christmas time, in the context that the ghosts are presenting to Scrooge. So that was all I was going to bring up.
Right, right. They really leaned into one of his virtues, which is that he rarely participated in idle talk. He had a strong interior life that helped him, you know, avoid the gossip of and merriment of that Christmas time. I also really want to emphasize that he gave up the snares and seductions of that young woman Belle, and he chose, well,
he
you know,
said, "Begone, thought."
Yes,
it's the meme of like, you know, the black guy. He's like a nerd holding books, and there's like the thought that's like walking by him.
Yeah,
this
yeah.
Other guy, and she's like, and she Whoa. Comes. It's Belle, and she comes back, and Scrooge is all rich, but he's still pathetic.
Well, except
you know, he was just an insult.
Well, except that except when he's shown the image of what her life is like, he feels this. He wishes that he was the one who had all those children with her.
Mm-hmm. Which is the one based part of this that I related to. It was a very nice part.
I remember what I was going to say. It's one last joke before we can get to like AA's video. And it's that, you know what? My real deep take about this is that the whole thing of trying to bury St. Nicholas and replacing him with Santa Claus, it's a Unitarian Universalist plot, because like because these people are they're Neo-Aryans, and so they don't want to be people to be reminded of the guy who bitch slapped the Arius back in the whatever century it was. They don't want people to be reminded of the guy who's talking about the one substance.
Fourth century.
Fourth century, thank you.
So true. They're just absolutely terrified by Saint Nicholas. But yeah, we'll do the video now. Okay, we cannot hear this at all. Yeah, we can't hear anything.
Oh,
well, stream. What? Here's the thing, StreamYard's. You can only share videos on StreamYard if you download the video using a YouTube downloader, and then you use the share video function.
Yeah, yeah, no, I understand what you're saying files. Now. Then give me 30 more seconds. By 30, I'm at 60.
That's useful information to have.
Yeah, I learned that in preparation for my my live stream when I was reacting to that libertarian video. By the way, go and check out my channel, check out that video. I try my best not to make fun of the libertarian, but it's so difficult because they make it too easy.
yeah, by the way, in terms of downloaders, I would recommend using a J downloader. That's the one I use. I find it's it's pretty old actually. It's open source, and it downloads from basically anywhere. So if you want to download stuff from Twitter or even just images, you just paste in there. And, yeah, it's a lot better. You know, it doesn't have like Chinese spyware or something on it.
thank you. That's actually something that I needed. Okay, video file, A Christmas Carol. Sharing now.
Okay. What I'm seeing on the preview scares me, but okay, no, that's fine.
A man delays consumption for 30 years and then suddenly becomes very high time preference and spends a lot of his savings on the 25th of December, 1860. He is a moneylender called Ebenezer Scrooge. The people who are in his debt complain that they struggle to keep up with their payments. These people made poor entrepreneurial decisions and should not have set up unsustainable business models. This is not Scrooge's fault. When he writes off their debts, Scrooge rewards poor investments, ruins his own reputation as a lender who can accurately assess risks, and ultimately undermines his chief source of revenue.
Like, if you're going to, if you're going to extrapolate all this information about how Scrooge is forgiving debts left, right, and center, and he's and all of these people are just bad at business, why can't I just make my own extrapolation that Scrooge is a user and he was exploiting poor people using these kinds of legalistic contracts?
Yeah, I think it might be in this version that this happens. I don't even think in the book this mass debt forgiveness even happened.
Well, it doesn't. But the certainly Scrooge would probably be more forgiving of debts in the future if to avoid exploiting people who are like he's not going it. One of the fears of that one woman from the vision of the goat from the Christmas yet to come was that this one woman was poor, and because she was poor, she couldn't gather. There was this fear that she couldn't gather the money to pay off this debt in time, and Scrooge being the kind of, you know, sticking to the fine print of the contract, he would basically take whatever he could as collateral, which is a very common practice with usurers. I don't see any reason why this is just attacking the concept of Jubilee in general and debt forgiveness, which is very something very Christian. You can look at the Old Testament and it talks about Jubilee.
Yeah, every 7 years or something?
I think so. It's either every 7 years. Well,
wasn't
every
it like there's one type of Jubilee every 7 years and a different type every 77 years or something like that?
I'm going to have to look that up.
We'll have to ask Jimmy Akin about this.
Well, I mean, the problem with this is the same exact mistake that the libertarian made in that video that I reviewed. He was extrapolating all these things that just aren't in the text that he probably half remembered from.
Yeah, I think this isn't an extrapolation. An adaptation. I think this happens in this adaptation from like what I gather.
Well, I mean, the thing is, there's nothing wrong with having a jubilee.
You don't understand, Charlemagne. We have to fight autism with autism.
Yeah, I'm just saying, I don't think A is, like, misremembering. Like, it's probably just in this version the debt forgiveness happens. So we could just take it for granted that this thing happened in this version, right?
Yeah, well, I mean, I would still defend the debt forgiveness in this version because...
Yeah, of course.
I mean, Christianity is all about that kind of generosity. And it's
also,
not...
especially considering everything the ancients... Everyone from, like, Confucius to Aristotle saying, yeah, usury is bad and you shouldn't do it.
Yeah, and still, and the AA still defends it.
I doubt he would defend it now.
I don't know. I mean, he's... I've never seen him refute any of his. I've never seen him refute his old views before, or acknowledge that. There is only one video I've seen where he's acknowledged, yes, I had these views in the past, but now I've changed.
Well, in this particular case, I don't think he
refute, visited me in the night and told me you can't be attracted to abs anymore.
In this particular case, that's really funny. He probably wouldn't disavow what he's saying here in terms of the economic effects, because he actually is right that basically, if you just forgive like literally all debt instantly, like assuming that this entire everyone we see on the screen is in debt to him, and you just erase all of it, that could cause some serious problems, and it also could encourage like bad business practices. So maybe selectively forgiving certain debts, particularly to like really poor families, might be a good idea.
Charlemagne,
yeah, there's another reason. I support criminalizing all charging of interest for profit. But you know, I still understand that you can't just sort of implement sort of radical policies like that without any care for how that will affect the economy as it currently exists.
Yeah, because the economy as it currently exists basically runs on usury.
Yeah.
Yes, this is why AA might be right here for another reason. You know, Scrooge's, you know, debt forgiveness might have been an imprudent, you know, catalyst for a deflationary collapse.
Well, let's see what he says. Let's see the rest of it then.
In the long run, the economy will be worse off without Scrooge delaying consumption as he did for the previous 30 years, because now all the money is spent and there is none left for investment. If he really wanted to help Tiny Tim, rather than buying him a massive goose and doubling Bob Cratchit's wages, he should have offered him a chance to become a business partner through salary sacrifice. In the long run, Cratchit could then have taken a share of profits and gotten richer. He would have been delaying consumption as an investment. As things stand, Scrooge is in the situation of only losing money. If he carries on like this, by the 25th of December 1861, he might have nothing left. He is...
Oh my god.
Okay, I think there's... So, okay, I understand, and I even kind of agree that if in this movie... He just like forgave the debts of every single one of his customers, and obviously Scrooge is just going to go immediately bankrupt. You know, I don't know if that is what happened in this adaptation. So I can't really speak for that. But if that is, then yeah, that's not something you can really just do and continue being a moneylender.
Yeah, you know, I have this very fascinating insight that I'm just going to share it with you right now. It's this nuclear take right here. Maybe, Charles Dickens, when he wrote this, wasn't really concerned with the long-term and large-scale economic implications of Scrooge no longer being usurious, but was more like trying to make a point about loving your fellow man. I don't know. That may be a little too radical here, but
obviously that. That is the point of the
yes
book. But my main problem with what AA is doing here is, so on the first point of just like forgiving everyone's debts immediately, yeah, I agree that that's probably a bit radical, probably not something that's really sustainable. But then when he's talking about the wages of Bob, that seems like a bit of a bait and switch to me. I don't think it's ridiculous that Bob is that, or I do think it's ridiculous that Bob is barely able to support his family on the wages of being a clerk for a very, very successful moneylender. I don't think there's really any similarity between the first thing that AA is citing here and the second thing.
The idea that he should be elevated to business partner instead of just being paid twice as much, which is just a pittance anyway. I don't really see what that has to do with the other point.
Well, I mean, the thing is, I remember, I don't know about you guys, but I remember reading for the book that Scrooge not only doubled his salary, but offered him a higher position.
I'm going to make you my partner. He has the same position that Bob Marley, Jacob Marley had. That would have been a very different story if it was Bob Marley.
Okay, yeah. So yeah, he gave him Jacob Marley's position as partner and doubled his salary. That is a significant improvement, and I don't see how that's a bad investment. But more to the point, I think AA is falling victim to the same fallacy that the other libertarian had, which is this idea that, you know, since we live in this perfect free market, all the wages of every worker is going to be exactly what they are worth on the market. So if Bob Cratchit is making a pittance, that must mean that his labor is just worth that little, and that he just needs to improve his skills. The other libertarian goes as far as to say that Bob Cratchit is lazy or unimaginative and just goes out of his way to disparage him constantly in order to, and that's sort of what happens when you have that frankly Scrooge-like mindset where you think that everybody is, you're measuring the worth of a person by their money. But moving aside that is all, it also goes against the Christian idea of the just wage, which is, you know, a day's worth of work for a rich lender like Scrooge is objectively worth more than what Cratchit is getting.
Yeah, obviously, because it's facilitating Scrooge's riches.
Well, exactly. It's one of the things that... I can cite Heinrich Pesch, who argues that if you are working a day's worth of work, then that has to be objectively it has to be objectively a living wage because. In a pre-industrial society, in a society before money, if you were to work a day's worth of labor, then you would have gained enough money for obtained enough wealth for.
You will have had enough money for subsistence based off of your day's labor.
Thank you. Yes.
Or else it's literally impossible for there to be a labor market and it collapses.
Well, exactly. I mean, exactly. Yeah, that is exactly what I was going to say. And Heinrich,
I'm just Pesch, you at Ben Shapiro speed.
Says if you are unable to do that. Yeah, if Heinrich Pesch says if you are unable to do that in this kind of industrial society, either your employer is really bad at managing your labor, or he's underpaying you, or the business you are working for has such low demand that you can't actually justify paying you a living wage without going into debt, and therefore does not need to exist.
Do you think Charles Dickens ever ran into Karl Marx when he was in London and was like, this guy is a complete freak?
Well, it's kind of funny because I remember reading that Karl Marx really liked Charles Dickens' books and said Charles Dickens, A Christmas Carol.
Did he actually read them?
Well, I mean, he said that it was more revolutionary than anything I've ever written or something like that, which I guess it's true in a sense. It's Christianity is way better than Marxism.
Communism, yes.
Let's continue with the video.
Chastised by people for the fact that Bob Cratchit does not get a pay rise in 6 years. However, these people do not take into account that the...
Okay, who is chastising Cratchit? Who is chastising Scrooge for underpaying Cratchit? Who? It's not Cratchit.
It's the story.
I mean, yeah, it's only Dickens, the narrator of the story. It's not Cratchit himself. It's not Fred, despite what the libertarian.
But Geocon, look at the deflation. Look at that deflation there. He made 10% more.
1950s were a time of deflation. That means the prices of consumer goods fell. Therefore, Bob Cratchit's real wages increased during those 6 years. He would have been better off in 1860 than he was in...
That's pretty awesome.
That data.
Okay. This is just wrong, though, because these are not the years that A Christmas Carol takes place.
It was written in 1843.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah, I don't know if that's maybe when the movie he watched took place, but I don't know. And I don't know, perhaps the 1840s could have been a period of deflation too.
Well, look at this. Look how insane this fluctuation is. You go from negative 14.4% inflation to 15.6%. like, man, this is what early industrialization does, I guess.
It is mega deflationary. That's probably what caused the massive deflation, to be honest, and everything. But I like how he literally does use the stats. Perfect libertarian artist.
Yeah, no, but so, and I also want to add, though, that this is ridiculous. Okay, yes, it's true. I mean, it's not true, because as I said, the years are just completely off. But even if it was true, your labor is still worth more when you've worked for someone for a long time. That's why, like, you don't just get raises to keep up with inflation.
Also, do you think Charles Dickens was looking at the tables of inflation rates at the time? Was like, ah, oh, damn it, I can't use this. This ruins my entire book.
Yeah, but that's the thing that these libertarian types are saying. They're claiming that Charles Dickens says that Bob Cratchit is not paid more, but really, if you look at the stats, they were paid a lot more.
These stats are aggregate as well. So, I mean, we don't really know to what degree they were affected, whatever. I don't know if it's named like where they're actually living. We don't really know to what degree their economic situation is affected by these aggregate rates.
Yeah. Cost of living can be different from what the overall inflation is.
Just look at like the economies in the various U.S. states, right? I mean, the prices for, you know, things like housing and gas are vastly different across the country. And if you aggregate all that into just one stat, it doesn't necessarily reflect some individual circumstance.
Yeah, well, moving on.
1854 on identical wages. However, during those 6 years, he made poor, high time preference life decisions. For example, by having 5 children with his wife.
This just is the absolute worst. He's literally just telling, you know, I really hope that AA would not still make that same argument, but he's just telling Bob to, I don't know, have abortions or contraception or something.
Also,
shut it down.
A bunch of his kids are some of his older kids are working. So, and like, this is a time when like, well, wouldn't AA be like, well, he should have employed Tiny Tim as a chimney sweep.
His older children are working. Yeah. It explicitly says that I think the oldest child, Peter, is an apprentice somewhere. Child labor is still going on at this time. So presumably, not only Bob Cratchit is working, but his children are working, and probably his wife is doing something at the home. She's not sitting on her butt. She's probably if she's not doing house chores, she might be operating a cottage industry like so many women did at that time. So yeah, it's not as though the whole family is just lazy. All of them are contributing to the overall budget of the family. So AA is just projecting modern antinatalism talk as a way back onto the 19th century.
Yeah, and you know, as I said before, it's not like this is a job that doesn't produce much value. It's not like this is a poor company. Scrooge clearly makes a lot of money, and he can afford to pay his employee enough so his employee can have a normal family. Like that, this isn't
something. I mean, this is going to sound bad because again, none of this has anything to do whatsoever with the actual point of the book, but. I did notice, like, Bob Cratchit's not, like, the worst off. He's, like, he's like not starving on the street.
Well, but, yeah, I mean, he's
again,
not...
Again, this is not the point of the book.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, Scrooge is implied to be underpaying Cratchit because of his miserliness.
Okay, can I just read... That's right, go ahead.
Yeah, it's to the point. So that's the point of that is one of the things that Charles Dickens is pointing out. And the thing, AA is trying to do is he is using this antinatalist talking point, saying that Bob Cratchit, he had five kids, therefore. That must be a sign of his poor life choices, his low time preference. Exactly.
I have to read from someone from the chat says, was AA wearing a bow tie when he made this?
Wait. Isn't it high time preference when you prefer to have things now than more than later?
Yes. Well,
correct.
Okay. Yeah. Never mind. It's the opposite.
Oh, yeah. It's a sign of his high time preference to have a lot of kids, apparently.
Yeah. This is
sex with his wife. Disgusting. She probably had abs.
moving on.
At a higher rate than the increase in his real money wages. In other words, he failed to live within his means. This is not Scrooge's fault. By buying the massive goose for Tiny Tim, Scrooge ultimately killed the goose that laid the golden eggs. When his loan firm ends up going bankrupt in 1862, Bob Cratchit will lose his job. His income will reduce to zero. For Tiny Tim, this may mean that it is unlikely that there will be a 25th of December, 1863. Now get.
Yeah, well, that kind of
so wearing a leather jacket.
That mentions the point we made earlier, where, like, you know, if he just if he tanks his whole business, and Cratchit doesn't have a job, right? You don't want to do that, but.
there's three things that go on in there's three like economic choices from Scrooge that are mentioned by AA here. Forgiving all the loans, which isn't in the book, doubling Bob's wages, and buying the goose. And it's just the first one is really just not equivalent to the other two.
Yes, for sure.
Because I'm pretty sure Scrooge can afford to buy a goose and
the biggest Christmas goose
and pay a family wage. But he also probably can't afford to forgive everyone's loans. If buying them a goose is what causes Scrooge to go under, then it's probably means that Scrooge wasn't a very good businessman to begin with.
But I mean, AA is just writing fan fiction at that point. We know that the canon of the book, meanwhile, that if Scrooge kept on paying Bob Cratchit the wage he did, then Tiny Tim is going to die, probably pretty soon too.
I don't want to bring this up, but I'm just thinking. Well, like the implication is, okay, they have more money, they can afford medicine. This is the 1840s, so there's a chance the medic is going to kill him even faster.
I mean, I just kind of assumed that with more money, they'd be able to have like a healthier diet and a healthier sure. lifestyle.
They're going to assist on grain instead. They're not going to be true Bronze Age mindset on step plane warriors.
So,
fun trip to the past.
Yeah, I did actually invite AA on, so he'd be able to defend himself and give his updated views, but He never responded to my message, so that's why.
Gamers, please respond.
Get cut.
I hope he sees this video. I just want AA to know that this is all in good Christmas cheer. We're just having a laugh, kind of like how, you know, there's this one beautiful moment in the novel where Scrooge sees his nephew sort of making fun of him, and during his Christmas party, and he's able to have a good laugh at himself. And that it kind of shows some of Scrooge's good qualities, because I know he started exhibiting those qualities from the moment that he first journeyed into the past. But seeing he's able to laugh at himself. He's able to have a little bit of self-awareness and see, yeah, I am kind of ridiculous. And I think that that's a redeeming, that is certainly a virtue that he has. And I hope that AA has a bit of that virtue too.
I'm just thinking now of, like, you know how there's like Rosencrantz and Guildenstern are dead? Like the idea of like taking classic literature and making like fan fiction from a different character's perspective. Is there like some random guy that talks about the aftermath of the economic collapse that was caused by of the great economic collapse caused by the fact that this one guy stopped being usurious and exploitative, all and turned into like this horrible slum, and the British Empire collapsed.
Or you could write a Christmas Carol from Scrooge's perspective, but where he explains Austrian economics to the ghosts.
Well, you see, ghosts in the long term. This is actually, it's like there's a Monty Python sketch where like Austrian painter man like runs for like local office in Britain, and it's just asking people, what do you think about it? And there's like John Cleese is dressed as a businessman. He's like, well, I think it'd be very good for the stock exchange. This kind of reminded me of that.
So true.
I'm having a great time.
To be honest, I did not know the stream was just going to be a fatwa against the Lulbert, but...
Well, I mean, A Christmas Carol is just...
Anti-materialistic.
Yeah, I mean, it is just a fatwa against the Lulbert and the pure and kind of the Puritan that was kind of the proto Lulbert. You know, that kind of extreme version of the Protestant work.
It's almost like Gnosticism in the reverse, where only like physical accumulation of wealth is a sign of spiritual purity.
Yeah, I mean, I can just say, cold, darkness, and evil are all cheap.
Mm-hmm. And that's a line from the book, right?
No.
He does say like darkness is cheap.
Cold ain't cheap down here in the South, I can tell you that.
I mean, he actually does say that darkness is cheap in the book. And I think that's sort of symbolic of, you know, his overall life situation. And it's kind of interesting how the book narration describes Scrooge as being so bitter and cold-hearted that the winter wind doesn't even affect him. And that's why he keeps his office so cold.
That's kind of base, to be honest.
No, it
is.
Is pre-conversion Scrooge really just the peak Nietzschean? He makes the world bend to his will.
If he is, then it shows what happens to the peak Nietzschean. He's going to be forced
stare too long into the abyss,
and then you go to hell.
Yeah.
Okay. In all seriousness, though, we know the story really isn't about him being a loper. We know it's not about him collecting all his shekels and being greedy. Because, you know, like you guys said, he had a puritanical, austere lifestyle, which is a virtue. You know, he wasn't fat. He was very skinny. These are good virtues. So obviously, like, oh, avarice is the main vice he had, whatever. But I think the actual greatest vice he had was pride, where he, you know, he only valued other people in terms of their, you know, relative competence in like business land, you know, all of his respectable business partners. He lorded over, you know, Bob Cratchit, his clerk and everything, you know, like took advantage of the people below him, which is a sign of pride and stuff like that. And always had the uppity attitude. Like he was too good. He was too, you know, prestigious and too serious to go to his nephew's dinner. I think these are the, you know, underlying qualities that actually defined the issue here. And you know, if we see like his reaction to the spirits, to the three spirits, it wasn't really all about him like reducing his avarice. It was him being like terrified of them and being humbled into submission, you know, to the point where like by the time it gets to Christmas present spirit, he's like, I'll go wherever you, where you tell me, just do with me what you will. You know, he becomes like the little children, as we know. And that's the true Christmas spirit of the story.
Amen. That's a very good take, actually. I had thought of something like that, but nothing so strange. Thank you.
Based.
You are based. Thank you.
So true. When is Settler doing the Are We Cringe stream?
Are we cringe or are we dancer?
Bro, it's happening.
I think I can settle this right now. Yes, we are.
I mean, speak for yourselves. I know one of my latest videos was me reviewing anime, but speak for yourselves. Well,
we don't
guys.
Watch anime, so we're not very based here.
I know.
I don't know. I mean, I don't think I've never watched Fairy Tail, but I'm pretty sure it's not based.
No, it's not. It's stupid, but it's not an isekai, so it's good. I don't want to talk about anime right now. We're talking. Okay.
Thank you. Thank
you. Get grilled.
Want me to talk to you about Warhammer? I got another 5 hours to kill.
So just wondering, when the story ends happily ever after, does Dickens like just outright say that he becomes an uber incel, because it says he lived upon the total abstinence principle ever afterwards?
Abstinence. When we hear the word abstinence today, we're generally thinking of like sex, but abstinence like just means abstaining from stuff and like
seeing spirits.
It's referring to like asceticism, like not being obsessed with material possessions in that context.
He kind of has to be opposite now, because he's kind of a little too aesthetic in that sense, because he didn't enjoy anything, and the most expensive thing in his house were freaking curtain rods or curtain rings. So I think he's going to be a little more generous with his wealth now, both to others and to himself.
Yeah, I think he's not going to... Scrooge's problem wasn't hedonism. Let's put it that way. If in a modern day, I think the difference between a modern day adaptation of A Christmas Carol and a present day one is that a modern day Scrooge would probably be this rampant hedonist, whereas this Scrooge.
So Bill Murray in Scrooged.
Yeah, it's like the Donald Duck Scrooge with the pile of money, the pool of money. I think Tony Press put it very well in elucidating the actual meaning of the story.
There is a little movie from the 80s with Bill Murray called Scrooged, which is like, if imagining Scrooge like that.
Yeah. I mean, versus, again, I think Charles Dickens was writing about a particular caricature of a Puritan in from his day, and I think that while there are versions of that type of person that are alive and well, and they come in different forms, like the libertarian, arguably, I think that most people who are we consider wealthy are pretty much the opposite of Scrooge. They're outright hedonists who are overly indulgent and are able to get away with it because, well, they are so exploitative that they can just get money from, I guess, government printing or something.
Yeah. You know, sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, I think the term is too big to fail.
Yeah, yeah. So are we done? Do we have more to say? Where are we at?
I think Christmas 21st time, capped it, Will.
Christmas time is here. Christmas time is... I love that Vince Guaraldi, not going to lie. That's my Christmas nostalgia.
Oh, yeah. Okay. You can't go wrong with Charlie Brown.
I would like to I would just like to say for Zach here that I hope his funeral tomorrow is very good and pleasant. Thank you everyone.
Cringewalker's whining about his NFT super chat.
Okay. Would Scrooge mint NFTs and or trade Bitcoin?
Seller, I can save this completely cringe super chat. So, you know, Bitcoin's like the analog for digital gold.
Okay,
like
nope, 21st. This is a $2.
Are we gonna think
you do not get permission to spurg out over this?
He would hodl his crypto, his Bitcoin shekels. That's
nope, you're getting muted. Cringewalker's gonna have to pay more than $2 for cryptocurrency to be allowed to go off on Bitcoin.
Steampunk Bitcoin mining.
Yeah. Okay. Yes. Thank you very much, Cringewalker. And also, as I've said previously, thank you, Cringewalker, for your for doing the thumbnails. I very much appreciate it. You're one of my two favorite minions. You and 21st. Can't choose between you. But
you'll have to pay more money for serious super chats.
Yeah.
Okay. I forgot to say this is. Because I only noticed it recently, you have finally surpassed me, Settler, even though I don't really upload that much anymore. Oh, you finally did it.
Yeah, so true. Cringewalker's quite right here. For only $50 a month, you can have a channel in my Discord server dedicated to Bitcoin. So everyone, please shill your stuff.
I guess I should probably be on the cigar stream again on Wednesday. It is now. We're going to be doing some Uncle Ted stuff. It was delayed from this week, which is actually good because I should be able to do the reading. Oh, one thing I should chill is Apostolic Majesty announced a Tolkien Day on January 3rd. And of course, he has invited people to participate. So if anyone is interested in making videos for, you know, Tolkien Day on the 3rd, contact him on Twitter or, you know, wherever you can get in touch with him. I think just Twitter, really. Keep an eye out for that, which is coming up soon.
Yeah, I mean, that kind of sucks. I might have done something for that, but that's really soon. So I don't know if I can prepare anything that time. Which means that reminds me, I would like to announce on March 22nd, I'm officially going to be doing a Pokemon Coliseum Day. Nice. Stay tuned for that. If anyone would like to participate in that with me, you have 3 months plus notice. Who else would like to show? Fritz, go ahead.
I'm Fritz Imperial. I've kind of just started re-uploading again. I mean, I'm busy with my job and all that, but I think there's a chance either tomorrow or someday soon I'm going to be having some of my friends on, and they're going to be red-pilling me about the Battletech lore, and it'll be fun. I'm going to probably be on my friend Argent Templars because he wants to stream with me about Warhammer 40k at some point. And I'm also going to be trying to stream on Twitch again, hopefully soon. I'm going to be streaming the Warhammer Mechanicus game. If you can't tell, I really like 40K, but I'll keep that autism away from here for right now. So subscribe to Fritz Imperial. You can follow me on Twitter and on Twitch.
Okay. Ghost of Buckley.
Yeah, I run the channel Applied Virtue. You can look it up. I am currently working on a edited video series about the ethical uses of internet and other technologies. So look forward to that. Also, take a look at my blog on Substack. It has a lot of essays about natural law ethics that you might like. I'm working for that blog. I'm working on my next essay, which is going to be a sort of a deviation from my previous work. And it's going to be about paganism and Christianity. So check that out. What else? I also make live stream videos about anything that really comes to mind. So if you have a topic you want to talk to me about, you can message me on Telegram and maybe I'll make it into a video.
The ethical nature of this stream has been put into question.
What?
He said he was making videos about the, you know, ethical uses of the internet. No, but anyway.
21st, go ahead, chill.
St. Nicholas was a double super giga chad that paid for women's dowries, paid them out of prostitution. He was holy heckin' based, and we need to bring him back for Christmas. Merry Christmas, everyone. But also, I might make a video soon. I might not. I'll leave you in suspense, but keep Christ in Christmas. Like, that's the one thing the boomers still say that I love. Keep Christ in Christmas.
So true. What am I doing? I should have said this at the beginning of the stream, meant to, but I totally forgot. If there's anyone out there that would like to be a new minion for me, that would like to be an art minion, I would very much appreciate that. I'd like to get some original art for this channel. So if there's anyone that's good with art, send me a message on Discord or Twitter. Discord's probably better. I'll try and say that at the beginning of the next stream, because, you know, I know almost no one's listening at this point. I remember like a year ago I made this same request, and some people did actually message me, and I never got back to them. I was just being really lazy. So if you're one of those people and you're still interested, just send me another message. I wasn't trying to slight you. I'm just really lazy sometimes. Subscribe, donate, go to church on Christmas Eve and or Christmas Day, submit to the Pope. That's
pretty subscribe much it. To Settlers Lament.
And pray for me. Thank you guys for everything, and goodbye.